Psalm reading this morning is from Psalm 116. I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy. Because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came over me. I was overcome by distress and sorrow. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Lord, save me. What shall I return to the Lord for all his goodness to me? Will I lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord? I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servants. Truly, I am your servant, Lord. I serve you just as my mother did. You have freed me from my chains. I will sacrifice a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the house of the Lord, in the midst of Jerusalem. Praise the Lord. Precious and loving God, we do indeed praise you this morning. You are the God that has sustained and carried us through many trials and tribulations, and who has walked with us in great joy and in great happiness. And so, Lord, there is much that we are thankful for, and much that we can do to give our praise to you. Certainly fulfilling the vows that we have made to you through our baptism, through our commitment to following you, to honor those things. And Lord, we come this day renewing that sense of faith and encouragement and vows within each and every one of us as we worship and celebrate you. This day, Lord, our songs, our prayers, our praise are all meant to glorify you and to give praise to you, as the psalmist said. Praise the Lord. In his name, Jesus' name, we pray and worship. Amen.
Amen.
Our next hymn is Open the Eyes of My Heart. If you would, please stand as we sing together our praise song.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
need our concerns and our joys this morning. So what concerns do you bring that we might lift up to God this morning? So
We found out Friday that Candy's friend Matt had three seizures. Yeah. So we don't, I didn't hear anything yesterday, so I don't know what they decided to do to put him back in a coma. They're still doing really good, and now they're not looking so good. So we'll keep Matt in the prayer.
And we've been praying for Matt. This is a friend of Fred's daughter Candy. Y'all know Candy. Young man, he's not very old, a young family, and he had to be put into a coma because of the seizures, and they brought him out of the coma, and thought he was doing better, and now the seizures are back again. They're still not sure what's going on, and so he's been in the hospital for a while. It's like he's going to be there for a while, so remember that family in the first thing. So, Millie?
My cousin, Mary Ellen's son, has cancer, and they're doing radiation. Something about that radiation or whatever it was they're doing has created the opposite effect from what they wanted, and it's causing his kidneys to shut down. So he's having a real rough time. His name is Eric Green.
Okay. Eric Green, remember him? Problems with his radiation, chemo.
I'm not sure which it was. It was.
But one of them, trying to treat the cancer,
and it's, and it's not working on him right.
Okay. Other prayer concerns this morning? All right, joys and celebrations that you would share with us. Most gracious and loving God, this is certainly a place where we can gather on this Sunday morning. We come here, and we come not always fully aware of the reasons that we're coming, or not even fully aware of what we're expecting to happen when we are here. But we do come with a sense of expectation that your Spirit, Lord, might just move in our lives this day. The things that maybe have been hidden from us might be made clear to us. That moment when we've reached the end of our rope and we see just a little bit of hope in that moment. We come when we think that there is no reason to come, but we come and we find that the joy of celebration and fellowship has renewed us for the days ahead. And while, Lord, certainly there is much that we gain from this, we pray, Lord, that what we do in these moments, that it reflects our faith and our love for you, and Lord, that you are praised in these moments as well. We know that because we are people that come into this place, there are many that can't or won't or can't bring themselves to be here today. Some because, Lord, they would love to be here, but they are sick, they are in the hospital, they are suffering, and they are hurting. And Lord, we pray for your healing touch on them. Pray that you be with those families of the ones that are going through these times of sickness and illness. Sometimes it's hard to sit in that hospital room and to wait. And so we pray strength for them and healing for those that they are ministering to. And Lord, there are those that just can't come this morning. The pain that they are feeling from just life could be the grief that they are suffering. The pain of just having to deal with all of life's experiences, and they just feel a sense of being overwhelmed, and to go and to do one more thing, it just seems overwhelming to them. Lord, we pray that you will be with them, giving them a sense of peace and calm and strength, Lord, to face the difficulties and the dark days that they are experiencing. And for, Lord, those that are traveling and are removed from this place this morning, we pray for their safety and pray their safe return in days to come. For, Lord, those who are outside the walls of this church and often wonder what goes on in here, I pray, Lord, that we might be given a vision of what they are experiencing or what their eyes are seeing or not seeing, and that we might have eyes that would see them. And, Lord, that we might be able to present to them the very thing that we love the most, the very thing that brings us the greatest joy, and it is your presence in our lives, and that we might be able to share that with those who are on the outside wondering, what is it about this place and those people? Do they have something that could be important to me? Do they have a word that they might speak that would give me hope and peace and joy and comfort? Lord, may our eyes be open to all of those possibilities. And Lord, we do thank you. Thank you that we have this place. Thank you for those that serve in our militaries, our police, our firemen, rescue squad, all of those, Lord, that stand between us and harm and evil and hurt and pain. Lord, we thank you for them and their faithfulness, their courage to be there. We pray safety for them and for their families that send them off as well. Lord, we do give you thanks and praise that we have this opportunity to worship you, and we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who we celebrate and worship in our presence in this place this day. In Christ's name, amen. Y'all know that sometimes you see something, and it can be seen several ways, and you may not see it the same way somebody else does, and you may not see it, and then it may be revealed to you that there's something else that you are seeing. Y'all familiar with Duck Rabbit? This is Duck Rabbit. All right, what do you see? Tell me, what do you see? Just spit it out. Tell me, what?
A duck.
A duck. A duck. How many sees a rabbit? Oh, when I mentioned the rabbit and asked how many saw the rabbit, some of you went, oh, I see it. How many still can't see the rabbit? How many can't see the duck? Everybody sees the duck, it seems like, but you can't see the rabbit. Well, here's the ears of the rabbit, there's the mouth, and there's the eyeball of the rabbit. He's facing that way. The idea behind this is, it's a little psychological thing that was done several years ago. It's the idea that perception, what do we see? What do our eyes comprehend? And then once something is explained to us, when if you see the duck and then it is explained where the rabbit is, and you go, oh yeah, there it is, now I see it, or the other way around, then your eyes are open to a new possibility, a new way of seeing things. Well, that is what has happened in our story this morning from Luke chapter 24. a couple of guys' eyes were sort of closed. But once some things are explained to them, they are seeing a little bit differently. This is a rather long reading, but there is just not a good way to break it up. And so, and here a reading this morning from Luke 24, starting with verse 13. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still. They stopped in their tracks, faces downcast. And one of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" Jesus asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, Jesus explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." As they approached the village into which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he was going to go on further, but they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took some bread, gave thanks for it, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he disappeared from their sight. Poor guys. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us? Were not our hearts burning within us? While he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us," they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. God's word for you as people this day. Now y'all know this story. The two guys on the road to Emmaus, all the things that have happened over that weekend, Jesus' crucifixion being placed into the tomb, and then the women's account that the body wasn't in the tomb anymore. The stone had been was rolled away, no body in the tomb. And the disciples aren't sure about any of this, and they don't believe the women. And so these two are not part of the inner 12, but they are disciples. They are followers of this Jesus. And it appears that they have been with the disciples and with Jesus for some time. They are probably the ones that made sure that food was... that they had food, that there was lodging as they went on to the next places. More of the workers of the group, if you will. But they are involved. They know Jesus. They have seen Jesus. They have experienced talking with Jesus. He is not someone who has been far removed from them that they've seen at a distance. This is someone they know and know well. And so they decided to go back as Thomas did. Thomas decided to leave that day. These two decided to go back to their village. There's nothing else to see in Jerusalem. Jesus is dead, and now he's gone. We don't even know where he is, the body of Jesus. And so what's the point in staying in Jerusalem? If we stay here, we're at risk from the Jews and the Romans. And so let's just go home. And so they start out walking towards their town of Emmaus. And as they're walking along, you know the story. Jesus just comes up alongside of them, wants to know what's going on. Well, they don't recognize Jesus, and it is deliberate. They are kept from recognizing him. much like the duck rabbit picture, you see what you want to see in front of you. They were not expecting to see a Jesus. They were not expecting him to be walking alongside of him. They believed him to be a dead body who had been removed from a tomb and laying out in the dirt someplace. Somebody had done something with him. So their perception is that Jesus would not come alongside them. They are kept from seeing him. Whether it be through the miraculous power of Jesus Christ, which is entirely possible, or their own, as Jesus said, their own foolishness, their own inability to believe what they are actually seeing. One of some of the versions say their hearts were hard to believe. And so there is that sense that whatever it is, this person standing beside them is not who they are expecting it to be, in the form that they expect him to be in. And so they walk along with him. They are amazed that this man who is coming from Jerusalem doesn't know anything that has happened in Jerusalem. The two of them have been talking about it, as you would expect. What happened? Do you understand what happened? Do you know what's going on? Do you have any? And they're trying to process this. And this Jesus comes alongside of them. And after they explain to him what little bit they know about what has happened, and then Jesus tells them how foolish you are and how slow to believe what the prophets have told you and what you have seen with your own eyes. And then he goes on and he starts telling them all the things from Moses all the way up through his death, all the things that the prophets have said about him. He makes clear how he had been prophesied that he would be this, he would be this, he would be the man, he would be the suffering servant, he would be the one whose body would be broken. All of the things that had been said about him all the way up to that moment. Their hearts are starting to warm. They're starting to feel that there's something here. There's something about this man, the way that he talks, the things that he says. Something doesn't. You know how you get sometimes when you're right on the verge of something? You're reading a story and you think you understand all the stories. You're seeing a movie and you think you understand where the movie is going. You think you know who the criminal is, or the murderer is, or who the hero is, and but you can't quite put it all together. It almost makes sense, but not quite. That's the way they were feeling. They go on and they get close to the village. It's a long walk. It's 7 miles, and so it's a good little walk. And so when they get to where they're going, their home, Jesus indicates he's going to go on. He's going to keep walking, knowing, or hoping at least, that they'll invite him in. And they do. It's a dangerous road at night. It's dark. There's robbers. There's all kinds of things out there. And for them not to have invited them in, him in, would have been a violation of Jewish hospitality rules. At the very least, they have to invite him in. They want to invite him in. They don't want to see any harm come to him. And so they're extending to him the hospitality of their faith. And he comes in with them. They set a meal. They put bread. They put wine. They put all the things out on the table. And it's when Jesus picks up the bread and breaks it and blesses that bread that all of it starts to make sense to them. It is in that moment that they see the rabbit. They've been seeing the duck all along. And Jesus has been explaining to them, there's a rabbit here. All you got to do is see the ears and the mouth and see all the fuzziness of it. Bless this bread. There it is. That's the piece that we were missing. That's the thing that kept us from fully seeing and understanding. Their eyes are opened in that moment. They realize who Jesus is. And just as they realize it, and just as they're ready to really embrace this Jesus and really get into a conversation with him, and I bet you they had about 1,000 questions that they were just dying to ask him in that moment, the bread breaks, their eyes are open, and it's that second they're going, Jesus, what? And he's gone. All the sudden are different and change. They were expecting a dead body laying in a field someplace. They were expecting a body decomposing. They were expecting all of the things that this life offers, the death, the decay, the destruction. And in that moment, that breaking of the bread, in that realization that everything they thought they understood changes. Everything changes for them. Life isn't the same anymore. Eyes are open. And then when he just disappears, they really do start to understand what is happening. All of those words that Jesus had spoken to them about the prophets, all of the things that had been said about them, it starts to come back up inside of them. They start to understand the stone that will be destroyed and rebuilt in 3 days, how that temple of Jesus Christ will come back. All of that starts to make sense now. And so what do? Well, they hold on to it. They don't want to tell anybody about this because they figure it's important that they keep it to themselves, right? They, you know, I got to hold on to this. And there's no point in telling anybody else because nobody else is going to believe what I have to tell. No. After a few minutes of just sort of catching their breath, realizing what had happened, without any question, it's dark, it's night, it's a long way back into Jerusalem. They don't wait till morning. They don't wait till the next day. They get on the road that night. They make their way back to Jerusalem. I'd love to be in on the conversation on that 7 miles from Emmaus to Jerusalem, between those two. The sense of joy and the sense of wonder that they must have been experiencing on that walk would have been absolutely amazing. They get back to Jerusalem, they find the disciples. Jesus has already appeared to Simon Peter, and so Simon is aware that Jesus is resurrected. These elaborate that story and verify and tell what has been told to them. And now the disciples start to realize things aren't what we thought they were. Things are different. And their eyes become open as well. This is a story for us. This is a story for those of us that feel that sense within us that something is going on. That there is something happening and moving. Whether it be in our lives, whether it be in your individual life, you get that sense that something, your heart is being warmed even now. You don't understand exactly what it is, can't quite make sense out of it yet. And I'm praying for you that there will come that moment when the Spirit of God reveals the rabbit to you. When all of a sudden the bread is broken, the rabbit is revealed, Jesus Christ is opened up to you and your eyes, your heart, your very soul goes, that's it. That's what I've been looking for. That's what I thought was happening and now I see it fully. It could be through a scripture reading. It could be through a song. It could be through a prayer. It could be through the hug of someone that you love dearly. It could come in any number of ways. The thing is, you've got to be open to the moment that it can happen. These two, on the road to Emmaus, they were being continually prepared for this. And in the moment, they made sure. They could have let Jesus go on. They had that choice. They could have let him walk on and not invited him in. They kept bringing him in closer and closer to the moment where it could be revealed to them exactly who he was and what he was. And so you have to keep that in mind as well as you are experiencing this warming of your heart to not push Jesus away, to continually be bringing him in closer and closer and closer to you, so that in that moment when the bread is broken, your eyes are open, when the rabbit is revealed, you have that ability to be there at that moment and experience that moment, a moment of joy and great comfort and a great peace to you. In that moment when you realize all that Jesus has done for you, all that his death and his resurrection means in your life, you may have already accepted that. You may have already gone through the waters of baptism. You may already understand your sinfulness and your need for Christ in your life. you have been pushing it away and you haven't really embraced all that it is that Jesus wants to reveal to you about himself. And so I'm asking, keep Jesus close. Keep talking to Jesus. Keep walking with him. Keep inviting him in. And in some moment, the bread's going to break and your eyes are going to be open, and you'll see the path that Jesus has for you and the way that Jesus wants you to go. I speak from experience on this. I know what I'm talking about. I have walked that path. I have experienced that moment when my eyes are open to what Christ, what Jesus, what the Spirit has for me. And I know it can happen for you as well, if it could happen to me. And so keep yourself open to that. And as a church, we have a responsibility. And this sounds silly, but we have a responsibility to keep Jesus close to us. Because there is much that the church collectively keeps its eyes closed to. We think we're close to it, and sometimes the church thinks, and Blackwell and others, we think we've already had our eyes opened, and we think we see clearly all that we are to do, only to have in a moment it revealed to us that no, we don't. We don't have our eyes fully open. Things are still not what they should be. We feel it, a warmth in our hearts collectively as a people. We feel that we're on to something. We feel there is something almost on the verge of something happening. There is that sense that the Spirit of God is trying to do something within us. And often we just sort of push it away. We start arguing about the carpet. We start arguing about all of the other things. The deceiver, the Satan, has a way of slipping in there and making sure that our eyes and our hearts are turned away from Jesus the Christ and all that he is wanting to reveal to us. So as the disciples in Emmaus had to do, and they kept pulling Jesus closer into them, that is what we need to do as a church. Continually pulling Jesus in closer to us through prayer, through study, through worship. All of those ways that we pull Jesus in, and in that moment when we least expect it, when we don't realize that it's even getting ready to happen, Jesus reveals himself in a way that we never thought about before. But then after it's happened, we go, yeah, I felt something was going on. I felt it. And here it is. But if we don't keep Christ close, if we don't keep continually near to Jesus, we may miss that moment and that experience. That is where I feel Blackwell is at this moment. That we're close. I feel it in my heart. There is a warmth and a sense within me of something that is happening. And I can't quite pull it all together yet. I see pieces of it coming together. Room at the inn, the law, feeding the hungry, working at Sheep Barney, worship and prayer, Wednesday night Bible study, activities. It's all here. I'm on the road. We are on this road with Jesus. And he is telling us, he is speaking to us all the things that has been revealed through the prophets and through the gospels and through Paul and the writers. And all of this is there. And I just don't want to push Jesus away. I want to keep pulling Jesus in closer, because I know at the right moment, the right time, at the right place, that bread is going to break. That rabbit is going to be revealed. I'll see it more clearly, and you will too. And then we'll have a sense of direction. And we'll be like those two in Emmaus. We won't want to keep it to ourselves. We can't keep it to ourselves. Doesn't matter if it happens on a Wednesday night at 8 o'clock. We're going to want to go out and tell somebody. We're going to want to do something. We're going to make something happen. So let's keep Christ close to us. Don't push him away. Bring him in through prayer in your individual lives. You can feel it. As a church, we can feel it. Let's keep Christ close, because I honestly do believe the duck that we're looking at is soon going to turn into the rabbit. We just need to see it differently. We need to have our eyes open to all that Christ can do. Our hymn of invitation is "Open Our Eyes, Lord," and that is exactly what we are looking for. We want our eyes open. And so perhaps you feel that warming in your heart even now. Individually, you feel that there is something going on. You've been trying to put the pieces together. Maybe this is the moment when your eyes are open to what Christ has done for you. The forgiveness of sins that came through the shedding of His blood. The resurrection that guarantees and gives life now and life eternal. That's what eyes open sees in this moment. And if you would like to know more about Jesus Christ and all that He can do in your life, all that He has done, come talk to me as we are singing, or talk to me after, or this week, come talk to me about receiving this Christ as your Lord in your life. And if you'd like to join with this church, be a part of us, and come and present yourself for membership as well. But let us stand together as we sing our hymn of invitation. Open our eyes, Lord. Please stand as you pray.
Go in peace. Mm-hmm.